celebrate the exaltation of your glorious cross with sacred hymns and songs. When you appear on the last day and the sign of your cross will shine brighter than the sun, gather us before you and surround us with your eternal light, that we may raise glory and thanks to you, to your Father, and to your Holy Spirit, forever.
Amen.
Peace be with the Church and her children. Establish it as a sign of the covenant for the salvation of his inheritance. By his cross he exalted the Church and gave joy to all people who believed in it. To the good one be glory and honor on this feast and all the days of our lives and forever. Perfect salvation, and made us worthy to celebrate this feast with hymns of praise, proclaiming, Blessed are you, O wood of the Holy Cross, for you erased Adam's curse and restored his banished children to their inheritance. Blessed are you, O Holy Cross, for you united heavenly and earthly beings. Blessed are you, O Holy Cross, for you fulfilled the words of the prophets, enlighten the apostles in their preaching, crown the martyrs for their faith, and honor the confessors for their loyalty. Now, O Christ, our Savior, we ask you with the fragrance of this incense to make the celebration of the feast of the exaltation of your holy cross a sign of security and peace. By your cross, exalt your holy Church, guide your shepherds, adorn your priests with virtue, purify our deacons, help the elderly, educate children, direct the young, protect orphans, care for widows, and grant rest in your dwellings of light to our brothers and sisters who have died hoping in you. May we find refuge in the shadow of your cross on that great day of your second coming, that we may raise glory and thanks to you, to your Father, and to your Holy Spirit, forever.
Thank you.
that incense that we have offered on the feast of the exaltation of your holy cross. May its sign always be visible before our eyes to strengthen us, that we may walk with you toward death, and then stand at your right hand to celebrate the feast of your eternal victory. We glorify you, your Father, and your Holy Spirit, forever.
The message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing.
from the senses. Kitty, it is.
Before the proclamation of the gospel of our Savior announcing life for our souls, we offer this incense and ask for your mercy, O Lord.
Peace be with you.
And with your spirit.
From the Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to St. Matthew, who proclaimed life to the world, let us listen to the proclamation of life and salvation for our souls.
Remain silent, O listeners, for the Holy Gospel is about to be proclaimed to you. Listen and give glory and thanks to the Word of the living God.
The Lord Jesus says, if anyone says to you then, look, here is the Messiah, or there he is, do not believe it. For false messiahs and false prophets will arise, and they will perform signs and wonders so great as to deceive, if it were possible, even the elect. Behold, I have told it to you beforehand. So if they say to you, he is in the desert, do not go out there. If they say, he is in the inner rooms, do not believe it. For just as lightning comes from the east and is seen as far as the west, so will the coming of the Son of Man be. Wherever the corpse is, there the vultures will gather. Immediately, after the tribulation of those days, the sun will be darkened, the moon will not give its light, and the stars will fall from the sky, and the powers of the heavens will be shaken. And then the sign of the Son of Man will appear in heaven, and all the tribes of the earth will mourn, and they will see the Son of Man coming upon the clouds of heaven with power and great glory. And he will send out his angels with a trumpet blast, and they will gather his elect from the four winds, from one end of the heavens to the other. This is the truth, peace be with you. The apostles admiring the temple, this huge esplanade in the ancient world in Jerusalem that Herod had been having built, that had been going on for over 40 years, 46 years we're told in the Gospel. And it was just being finished at the time of our Lord. And the apostles are admiring this architectural wonder. And what our Lord then, is he takes that wonder and he shifts it to a different view by beginning quite abruptly to say, you see all of this now. There's not going to be one stone left upon another. It's all going to be torn down. What it initially causes in them is shock. That's why they come up to our Lord and they ask, how is this going to take place? And when is your coming? When is your appearance going to take place? Often in English we translate it with coming, which gives us the idea that Jesus is going to come trucking down from somewhere else. But the term which is actually used in the Gospel is parousia in Greek. And parousia actually means appearance. And what our Lord then is doing is shifting the wonder of the apostles for them to come to understand that we live in a juncture of two forms of time. In the classical world, so as we come now to the end of the liturgical year and the season of the exaltation of the Holy Cross, it's the moment for us to consider the last things, death, heaven, hell, and to consider the aspects, obviously, of our individual lives. And so on this Gospel, the last week and this week brought together, our Lord is reminding us that we live in this juncture of two times. In fact, the Greeks had two different words for time. We only have one. So that while we have the time that we all know of linear, there is a beginning of creation, and the entire creation moves to a consummation and an end. So profound is this truth that even science knows that by the laws of entropy, it's all going to wind down at some point. But that's not the main issue that our Lord is talking about. What the second time is Kairos. Kairos is this present moment. And what our Lord is doing with the apostles is reminding them that in this present moment, there is a juxtaposition with the eternal. So while we have a linear beginning of time, to the consummation of all time, we have in the present moment a juxtaposition with the eternal. When our Lord enters into this glory, his appearance will be precisely that, not a coming here from someplace that he hasn't been, but a manifestation, an appearance, a parousia. And so what he does is he juxtaposes telescopes. It's further described in last week's bulletin and this week's bulletin to give you further details. But he telescopes the destruction of the Temple of Jerusalem with the end of time as we know it. Now the reminder of this present moment, of course, is that every moment we live with a very small veil, so to speak, between us and eternity. What our Lord is reminding us is that when he makes his appearance in his glory, that will be the transformation and therefore the ending of time as we know it. As the world is either disposed or not disposed to see the light, it will react accordingly to that presence of grace and light. This is why in the Gospel, in the Apocalypse, we have all these cataclysmic things that take place. It is not, the disappearance of our Lord is not about this cataclysm, as much as the modern world in Hollywood loves this apocalypse. Apocalypse does not mean destruction. In English, we talk about something apocalyptic as being catastrophic, horrible, wretched. Apocalypse in Greek means to reveal. It means to unveil, to uncover. And so, in the modern world, we're missing the whole notion of what our Lord is actually telling us. You must live in this present moment, us, each of us, with an awareness that at the same time juxtaposed is the eternal realm of light and grace. That light and grace touches us at each moment in gentleness and compassion, because the beginning of the world is to manifest life and existence, that creation as we have it portrayed to us in Genesis. In the redemption with the coming up of the Christ, we'll come back to the moment of the Christ to finish up. We have then in the death and resurrection of our Lord, the beginning of a period of time until the end of the world of compassion and of mercy and of life, of the supernatural life where that eternal has now touched the order of time. That's grace. And it is meant to bring us closer and closer and closer into that veil, to bring us into the eternal, so that what is supposed to happen at our death is we quite naturally, logically step through the veil into the eternal life. And I have to say, as in the passing, with the death of Daryl Mitchell this past week, that in the last 30 years of priesthood, I have rarely ever been given the gift and the grace to assist with someone who so peacefully, prayerfully, and well planned for passed through that veil. And so while it was obviously a great loss to all of us, and especially his family, there's also a great consolation of this is the way you do it. As we move to that juxtaposition, that order of grace, it is a gentleness and compassion which is given to us. But our Lord has said, I have come that they may have life and have it more abundantly. That is the parousia when our Lord appears. When he appears in glory, it is to give life, whether you are ready for it or not. That is why the world goes into convulsions, because it is not disposed to receive the eternal life of God. That is why the sun goes red, the moon doesn't give its light, the stars fall from the heavens. Creation itself, which is wounded by the sin, by original sin, the fallen world, is not disposed to receive this light. And so that when our Lord makes his appearance in the parousia, his coming in English, the world goes into convulsions because of that revelation. The apocalypse is not about destruction, it is about life. And it all centers around the Christ. So who is the Christ? What is the Christ? In the Old Testament, those 10, 15 centuries before the coming of our Lord, Meshiho in Assyria only means the anointed. Priests, prophets, kings, they're all anointed, usually physically with oil, the prophets more by the Spirit of God. But they're always considered, each of them in their anointing, they are considered anointed, and therefore Messiah, Meshiho, Christos, Christ. But they are all foreshadowings of the Christ who comes in the fullness of time, as St. Paul says. Which is why when our Lord says that many false Christs will appear, he's telling us something that is worse than in verse 11 when he says there will be false prophets. People who teach things that are wrong for one reason or another. But these Christs will work wonders. These pseudo-Christs will work wonders. And he says that they would deceive, if it were possible, even the elect. Those who are predestined to enter into the eternal light of the kingdom, they would be deceived. So profound will be the signs and the indications of these false Christs. St. John himself, in the very first generation, talks about that there are many anti-Christ present in the world already. But as those Christ, those anointings of the old law, foreshadowed the coming of the Christ, with a capital T and a capital C, there is all of these anti-Christ and anti-Christian, anti-Christ spirit,
which lead up to the coming of the Antichrist, with a capital T and a capital A. And on that as an aside, I refer you to Pope Francis's interview that he did in 2015. He recommended to the reporters on the airplane that were coming back from the Philippines a book by Monsignor Hugh Benson, written in 1907. And the book is called Lord of the World. And what Monsignor Benson did was to write a book in order to show how the end of the world very likely is going to happen. And so it's extraordinary that Pope Francis, with all of his optimism, all of his enthusiasm, would point out a book telling the reporters, you should read this, that has to deal with the end of time, the end of the world. It is, in fact, an excellent book. It has always been in print and is well worth reading. But to finish with, I want to leave you with a hymn that we sing each morning called the Nuro. Nuro in Syriac means light. And every morning in the morning office, every priest, every deacon, every religious sister, every brother, throughout the entire planet, all the Maronite Church and the Syriacs, we recite this hymn because it gives a magnificent vision of what is to take place. But the expectation of this moment is so great that we even have a liturgical term, the Protestants have picked it up, of Maranatha. Usually in English we say Maranatha. But it's Morantha. Morantha, our Lord comes. And as with Amen, Alleluia, Hallelujah, Lord Sabaoth, with these terms which are taken directly from the Aramaic, from the Hebrew, we also had Maranatha, that the Lord comes. Or it can also mean Lord come, this desire of this moment, of this unveiling. And that is what this great desire that is captured in this hymn of the Nuro. I'll finish by just giving you these couple lines. That the day is dawning upon us, this juxtaposition of eternal and of our moving ephemeral time. That the day is dawning upon us, the power of darkness is fading away. From the true light there arises for us the light which illumines our darkened eyes. Day after day, that eternal touches us in this time. His glory shines upon the world and enlightens the very depths of the abyss. And the hymn finishes by saying, arise, stand up now and be ready. Give thanks to our King and Savior who will come in great glory to gladden us with his marvelous light in his kingdom. This is the vision of time which moves linearly and of time which is each moment juxtaposed with the eternal. May grace touch us through that veil, transform us, allow us to see, strengthen us that we may stand with great expectation so that we all may say, Maranatha. Lord, come. May it happen in the next 45 minutes. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. We believe in one God, Father Almighty,
Maker of heaven and earth, all things visible and invisible. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ. The only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made,
Itemot madem eina loho, valvot aloho nam haletayut, veinem sumot aivoto, veinem lal baitof vesudem paiello, oko.
Thank you.
bound by your divine love and find joy in it all the days of our lives. Make us worthy to give one another the greeting of peace with the holy kiss, that through Jesus Christ our Lord we may be your radiant and blameless flood. We glorify and honor you, your only Son and your Holy Spirit, now and forever. Peace to the holy mysteries placed upon you. Peace to you, O server of minister of the Holy Spirit.
Let each one of us give a greeting of peace to his neighbor with love and faith, which is pleasing to the Lord.
Peace is flowing like a
and strayed from you by transgressing your law. You sent your only Son into the world for our salvation. By his saving passion, he restored us to our original inheritance and gave us life by his divine blood.
Oh, Maronite. With or without
living Holy Spirit, now and forever.
As it was, is now, and shall be forever. Amen.
Oh.
Again and again we thank you, Lord, and we raise glory to you, giving us your body to eat and your living blood to drink. The lover of all people, have mercy on us.
Have mercy on us, O Lord, O compassionate and merciful one. The lover of all people.
Spirit, the one God, to whom be glory forever.
Amen.